very well-known and well-loved woman of our Savannah community. Ms. Vera Hoffman has come today to share her story of strength, courage, and hopefulness, and it is my wish for today that we all, in our own way, are able to hear her tale of courage and endurance and find some part of her story that we can take away and apply to who we are as a sixth grade community and come to learn to love our people even more and more. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Ms. Vera Hoffman.
Microphone. I never wanted publicity. Growing up in Hungary and being Jewish, I didn't want to be seen and heard too much. And now here I am. I am the very last survivor of the Holocaust in Savannah. Most of the other people passed away. I was a young child, 8 years old, when I was taken away to the concentration camp. First, I like to acquaint you a little bit with my country. Hungary is in the very middle of Europe, a very beautiful country, and the capital is Budapest. I am not from the capital, I'm from the very southern tip of Hungary, so I can safely say I'm a southerner, but I'm a southern Hungarian. And my mother was a pianist. She taught piano at the Academy of Music, and she was also a voice coach, an assistant voice coach at the local opera house. My father was a pharmacist. He had a pharmacy and a dental supply store. I was an only child. I was born in 1935, which makes me now 81 years old. My parents were very comfortable, upper middle class intellectuals. I was enrolled in the local Jewish elementary school. We only had elementary school, Jewish elementary school. Later on, you went to different high schools, and I really enjoyed being there. The school was secular, which means that we only had religion 3 times a week, and we had other subjects, and was a very lovely school, very beautiful. It was next to the Jewish temple. We had a playground, but after school, I often used to go to the playground in the city. And in 1944, the Germans occupied Hungary. Hungary was the last country that the Germans occupied, and they started bringing in very rigid laws for Jewish people. First, we had to wear a yellow star on our clothes. It was in the spring of 1944. I was 8 and a half years old, and I had a navy blue spring coat, and I hated that yellow star on it. And I asked my grandmother if she could possibly color my coat yellow, but she said that she wouldn't and couldn't do that. She said, you have to do what they tell you because this is not so bad yet. I think my parents knew that worse was coming. They were just not telling me. We lived in an apartment in the heart of the city. My hometown is in the Great Plains region of Hungary, flatland, just like Savannah. And it's a university town. We have medical school, law school, chemistry. We have all the different subjects. We have a huge population of students to this day in my hometown. And I went to the playground again when the Germans occupied us. And all of a sudden, the same children I always played with started calling me a dirty Jew. So when I went home, I asked my father, what is going on here? As a child, I just didn't want to be discriminated. I didn't want to be different. What is this? Because Jewish people look exactly like other Hungarians, like Christian people. Hungary was always an anti-Semitic country, but we pretty well learned to live with anti-Semitism. As long as they were not killing us, we managed to live with it. And my father explained to me that this is because people's minds are poisoned from home, and the Jewish people were always the most convenient scapegoat. If something didn't go well in a country, who did we blame? Well, the easiest thing, let's blame the Jews. And that was the first time that I realized that I may be a little bit different from other people, not in a very good way. It hurts a child very much. And then many restrictions came. They took away the radios from Jewish people because they didn't want you to hear any of the news outside of Hungary, outside of what the Germans are feeding us. And then one day they came to our apartment, Hungarian people, with requisitions, and they started taking away our belongings. I remember standing there with my parents and people coming with brought movie companies, and they took my mother's piano, which was quite a heavy piece. She had a baby grand. And I never knew that my mother put her name on the back of the paintings, and she was watching very much so who took what. I also didn't know that when the Germans came to Hungary, one night my mother took a shovel and went all by herself to the Jewish cemetery and took a steel box with her and buried a lot of her belongings in my brother's grave. For example, this pendant I'm wearing was one of those pieces of jewelry. And also I had when I was born, I got a silver fork and a silver spoon with my name engraved on it. And my mother put that in the steel box also. My mother was a very interesting person. You would think being a musician, she wouldn't have that much common sense. But she was very practical. And she was the one that, in a way, saved our lives. And I remember hearing my parents speaking in the bedroom, and I was always a little pitcher with big ears. And my father said to my mother, Irene, I'm not going to be taken away anywhere or put through any more suffering by the Nazis, and I am going to commit suicide, which would have been very easy for my father, because being a pharmacist, he had all the medical equipment available to him. Of course, by then the Germans took away his pharmacy and took away the dental supply store also. And slowly they took everything away from us. And I had a lovely doll, and the doll's name was Susie, and they took my doll also, which was what hurt me the most. And then my mother took a little pillow and made my little Susie's face on it, and she gave it to me, and she said, Vera, from now on, this is gonna be your Susie. Hold on to her. And then the Germans took us into the ghetto, which was in every city in Hungary, an area that they closed off around the Jewish synagogue and the Jewish community center, and they put the Jewish people in there. It was about 2 or 3 blocks in my hometown, and we had 5,700 Jewish people in my hometown at that time. The population of my hometown is approximately the population of Savannah, which I would say about 180,000 people. So the Jewish population was not that big in comparison, but putting that many people into 2 or 3 city blocks, we were very cramped. There were 15 of us to a room in the apartment. These were apartment houses. And we didn't have much of any food, and we didn't have facilities to wash ourselves. And one day I remember I looked out in the courtyard and I saw a cage, like you keep tigers, animals in the zoo. And I said to my father, why are people in a cage? And he told me that they were in the local mental hospital and they were Jewish and they put them in a cage. And the next day they were gone. We found out later that they took them in the outskirts of the city and killed them all. And after the ghetto, we were taken to the outskirts of my hometown, where they had a brick factory, and we slept on the floor, and we had a latrine. I hope you never find out what's a latrine. It's basically a hole in the ground where you, how should I say it nicely, where you go to the toilet. It's hard to say these things nicely, and sometimes I'm translating in my head from Hungarian, which is my native language. But I also speak some, at that time, I was also fluent in the German language because both sides of my family were basically Austrians, and at one time Hungary was part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and a lot of Austrian people lived in Hungary, and some Hungarians also lived in Austria. And both sides of my family were basically Austrian Jews that settled in Hungary. So the native language in my house was German. And I grew up bilingual. And then we stayed in the brick factory with no food, no facilities for a few weeks. And then they started putting us on into cattle cars. I don't think any of you saw Schindler's List, which showed the cattle cars, but they have them at the port in Savannah too. Anyway, but my mother told my father, Paul, do not kill yourself. Till there is hope, there is life. Till there is life, there is hope. Sounds like a train station. And then my grandmother lived with us, my father's mother, and then we kept going in the cattle car. And I remember very well my mother asking my father, Paul, where are we going? And he said, we're going toward Austria. Dad had a very good sense of direction. And then they took us off the cattle car and made us walk. Later on, I found out this was a death walk, because anybody that couldn't move, the Germans and the good Hungarian Nazis, Hungary had a very strong Nazi party, they were shooting. And by then my grandmother picked up dysentery. She was up in years, and she had difficulty walking. And my mother, who was also very athletic, she was a very interesting woman, my mother. She carried my grandmother on her back and saved her life. And then they put us back into the cattle cars and we kept going. We got to a place in Austria called Strasshof. And I researched it and asked my parents later. This was a small town in Austria where they separated the Jewish people into different groups. Some went to the death camp, some went to Mauthausen, which was also a concentration camp. Not many people survived. And we happened to be lucky. I have some water. And it was just the luck of the draw. We ended up in a glass factory on slave labor. I was put to work making metal clasps for canning jars and soda bottles, mechanical, mechanized. There was not an electric machine. And by then the Allies were getting close. And most of the time we didn't have electricity, and I worked 12 to 14 hours a day. We lived in barracks, and we were full of lice, and lice causes typhoid fever, which is a very contagious disease, and some of the people in our group were dying left and right. I remember I was full of rice, and mother was able to get some kerosene and with a special comb tried to get the lice out of my hair, but she didn't succeed. And she always managed to get whatever she wanted. I think from the Austrians with her good looks and fluent speaking of the German language. She spoke Austrian German. And she got a machine and shaved off my hair. So by then I was bald and I was full of scabs that were oozing. But you still had to work, and we had very meager rations. Grandmother worked by the barracks in the so-called kitchen and was trying to cook something from nothing, and people were dying of malnutrition. Most people were getting very skeletal looking. And one day, when my mother worked in that part of the factory, the German officers came in and they said, "Is there anybody that can play the piano?" And mother told me later that she was thinking, should I tell them I'm a pianist, or should I keep quiet? They might just cut off my fingers. But she took a chance, and she said, "I play the piano very well. I am a teacher of the piano." And after that, she went into the officers' quarters every night to entertain the Germans, because there was no electricity, so therefore they had no record players, no music. And for that, they used to give my mother some food, fruit and bread, and nothing elaborate. Occasionally, they gave her a piece of cheese. And when my mother finished entertaining the Nazi, as she called them, the Nazi bastards, she would come in the barracks and quietly wake me up and give me the food that they gave her. And therefore, I was better off than some of the other children. And also sometimes in the early evening hours, my mother gathered the children together, because of course we had no school, and she would teach us, actually what she was teaching us, she would say the name of a famous composer and teach us what was his first name, what kind of music did he compose, and she also was teaching us some mathematics, which was my mother's other favorite subject. And that was about all the education we had. And one day they took us to a nearby village called Gemünden, because the Allies bombed out a train that was going through, and we were supposed to clean up the mess. And that train was also carrying some food, and whatever food was there on the ground, including frozen potatoes, because it was in the dead of winter by then, we ate, including I. First time I ate frozen potatoes, but when you're hungry, and we were always hungry, you're not very picky. And this went on, and less and less people stayed alive. By then there was very few of us. Luckily, including my grandmother, my mother and father, we were all living. We didn't know how long or what, but my mother always said, God has a plan for us, we're gonna survive. My mother was not what I would call deeply religious, but she was a strong believer in God's will, which was very hard to believe in that time, because you would ask, is it God's will that we have to suffer, that we have to be murdered? But I was too young to ask any of these questions. Older people I know asked, because my husband told me that's when he lost his faith. My husband died 3 years ago, but he was a survivor of Auschwitz. He was liberated in Bergen-Belsen, and he lost 3 brothers, a mother and a father, who were gassed in Auschwitz. Anyway, he didn't talk about it too very much. And then we were put together again, the ones that were still living and able to move, onto cattle cars. And the cattle cars were moving east. My mother asked my dad again, and he said, I think we're going toward Czechoslovakia. And then they took us off the cattle cars, because there was no railroad tracks anymore. The Allies bombed them out. And there was another death march. And whoever couldn't walk, they were shooting them again. And my mother carried my grandmother again, who was actually her mother-in-law. She wasn't overly fond of her, but she saved her life nevertheless. And we kept going till we got to a military encampment in Czechoslovakia called Theresienstadt. It was named after Maria Theresa, who was at one time the emperor of Austria-Hungary. And it was a military area, was a huge place. The army used to be garrisoned there, and the barracks surrounded a humongous courtyard. By then, it was April of 1945, and the Allies were very close, winning the war. My father always was able to talk to some of the Austrians in the factory, and so he pretty well knew that the war was coming to an end and the Germans lost it. And one day they took everything away from us. We didn't have much, but they took my little pillow, Susie, and they took everything to disinfect it, because the Germans were afraid that they pick up typhoid fever from us. We were full of disease and lice and many other diseases. I don't even remember the names of them. And then when they disinfected everything, they threw it in the middle of the courtyard. And I remember my mother going there, and she picked up the little pillow and gave it back to me, and she said, "Here is Susie, hold her." And then we ran out to the entrance of the courtyard, and we saw the Germans running away, and they were taking off their clothes because the Russian army was the ones that liberated us, the Red Army. And if they found the German, they immediately killed him. And they were throwing away their weapons and everything. And my mother bent down and picked up one of the small revolvers that one of the Germans threw away, and said to my father, I was standing between my parents, and there were a lot of other people around us, and said to my father, "Paul, show me how you use a gun." And he showed it to her, and she was just holding it, looking at it. And then all of a sudden, my mother shot one of the Germans, and he fell. And afterwards, I asked her, how did it feel to kill somebody? And she said, if I didn't kill him, your father would be gone, because one of the other Germans was pointing his gun at your father, and that's the one I killed. But she said, the way I felt at that time, I would have been very happy to kill them all. And then the Russians started examining us. There were some physicians, and they were going to try to treat some of the diseases. They didn't have much of any medicine or anything either. But my mother said to me, Vera, give me Susie, the little pillow. And I gave it to my mother, and she opened it up. I never knew it. The little pillow was hiding 14 diamonds. Nobody, I don't know, other than my father and my mother, that they knew it. And mother took out one of the diamonds and gave it to my father. And between other languages, my father always, my father spoke Russian also. He spoke 5 languages. And he learned Russian in the First World War when he was a prisoner of war in Siberia. And he went over to one of the Russian officers and talked to him. And he told him, I give you a diamond, take us back to Hungary. And he took us back to Hungary on his truck. And we arrived in Budapest. And Budapest was in shambles. Most of the buildings were full of bullet holes. The bridges, the Germans, when they left Hungary, dynamited all the bridges on the Danube River. And my father had a very good friend who was married to a Jewish lady. He was a Christian and Austro-Hungarian. And we went over to the apartment. He managed to save his wife. They didn't have much of anything to eat either, but they took us in. And my mother took to the streets again, looking for somebody that would take us back to my hometown in southern Hungary. And as always, she found a man who worked for the Hungarian pharmaceutical company and was going back to Szeged carrying some medicine with him. And we got on the truck again. This was in May of 1945. The Russian army liberated us in Theresienstadt the 8th of May. And when, I never forget, when we got back to Hungary, the lilacs were in bloom. To this day, the lilac is my favorite flower. We don't have any, unfortunately, in the south. But we used to live in Ohio, they had lilacs there. And we got back to my hometown, which wasn't bombed out. There was only one bomb that fell in on the railroad station. The rest of the city was intact. But we couldn't move back into our apartment because the Russian commando took it over. And a friend of my father came back from slave labor, and he pointed out an apartment, so happens exactly the one that we were in the ghetto. And he said the people that owned it died in the camp, and we should move in there. And we did move in there, and life started slowly going back to normal. One day my mother said to me, "Vera, I want you to come with me." And she had two police officers with her, and we went to an apartment in the city, and mother rang the doorbell, and a lady opened the door, and my mother said to her, "You have my piano." She said, "I do not have your piano." My mother said, "Yes, you do." And since we had two policemen with us, they had us let us go into the apartment. And my mother walked over to the piano and opened it up. And she said, "How come my husband's business stamp is in the back of it?" And she said, "Oh yeah, I think it must be your piano." And my mother got a moving company and got back her piano. And she did it many times. She got back some of our paintings, a lot of the things that the good Hungarian Nazis were very glad to take away from us. A lot of them were not very happy that any of us came back. But there were some decent people also, but not too many. Anyway, after that there was no more Jewish school, and I went to 2 years to the parochial school, Catholic school, which I loved. I got a good education there too. And then the communists closed all the schools that had any religious affiliation. And after that I went to public school. And I left Hungary in 1956 after Nazism, we had communism. And if you never experienced it, let me tell you, it's just as bad. My father built up his business again, and then the communists took it away from him. And he worked as a pharmacist in his own pharmacy, as a hired help. And we had a revolution in 1956, and by then I have had enough communism, and I left and came to the United States in February of 1957. So, in all reality, by the age of 21, I have been through the Second World War, the Holocaust, communism, and immigration. So I have lived a very full life. And then in America, I met my husband, who was also a Holocaust survivor. And we had a very beautiful marriage of 55 years till he died. I have two children grown. I have three grandchildren, and I have a great-granddaughter. So life went on. I made a new life in a new country. And that's about my story. You can ask me any questions you like. You have to speak loud because of I have an ear problem ever since childhood. Come over here. Then I can hear you.
That would be great.
Very good.
On that side? Yes. Go ahead, please.
Each other side.
They're going to share the mic with you, okay?
Okay, very good.
And we can hear the question.
As a Holocaust survivor, what do you think about recent calls to register Muslims, and what do you think we young people should do about it?
Well, I have a very good answer to that. Before I came to the United States, I was checked very thoroughly by the American Embassy in Vienna, Austria. And as long as you make sure that they're not telling you a tall tale and they're not terrorists, and we are capable of looking after them, we should let Muslims in. But you have to be very, very careful because they are a different culture, a different, really different religion, and they're not Western people.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So, how old were you when your camp was liberated, and how did you run into your husband, and like, was it by chance that he was also a Holocaust survivor?
When I went into the camp, I was 8.5 years old, and Cleveland is where I came to in the United States, has a very large Hungarian population. And I really met my husband on a blind date. We came from entirely different background. And now you're gonna have a good laugh. When he asked me to marry him, after 3 days, I said to him, "Joe, I do not love you. I do not know how to cook. And I'll never be religious." He said, "I love you enough for both of us. You may learn to cook. After what I lived through in the camp, I'm not very religious anymore." And we had a beautiful life together. I learned to love him, I learned to cook, and I'm still not very religious.
Do you know where your mother got the diamonds?
Oh, yeah. My parents made a beautiful living, and my father never wanted to buy a house. We always lived in an apartment. He said, being Jewish, we should buy, invest our money in diamonds, because you never know when you have to run, and you can put it in your pocket. That's my parents bought the diamonds from a friend of my father, who was a diamond dealer in Budapest.
And second question, also thank you for that. I only heard that 2 out of the 14 were used. So what happened to the other 12?
My father opened the business from some of the diamonds, reopened his business. My daughter has about 5 of them, and I have some of them that my husband, who was a jeweler, set into rings and earrings for me.
Thank you.
How did you feel when your dad and your mom had took someone's life? How did you feel when your mom and your dad took someone's life?
I didn't get the last one.
How did you feel when your mom and your dad took someone's life?
Took their life?
Mm-hmm. When they had to kill someone. How did that make you feel? Right.
How did it make me feel?
Yes, when they had to kill the soldier. Is that what you're asking?
Okay. It gave me a shock because my mother was a musician. She was never violent, but in a sense she saved my father's life. It didn't make me feel very good, but after I understood why she did it, I was okay with it.
It is such an honor to meet you. All right, so my only question is, what kept you going? Like, what motivated you just to hang in there? Like, what did you keep
going? Well, for me, it was easy. My parents, in a way, protected me. And I tell you what keeps us going. We love life. No matter what, people were doing anything and everything to stay alive. And I always had a zest for life, and in a way, after the war, I grew up in the opera house, because in order to talk to my mother, I sit through a rehearsal, and I learned to love classical music, which is one of the greatest loves of my life, other than my family. And there is so much beauty in art. And that's what, even after my husband died, that was the greatest solace for me. It keeps you going, the love of art.
Thank you.
It's an honor to meet you.
Thank you.
So, how were you able to escape Hungary because of communism? How were you able to escape Hungary because of communism?
We had a revolution, and for a few months, the border to Austria was open. And at that time, 300,000 Hungarians left the country, and we went to Austria. And from Austria, we went to different countries. Most of the European countries opened their arms to us. Number one, they knew that the Hungarians are very well educated, and they'd be an asset to the country. Just to tell you, I have many Hungarian friends here, and not one ever needed to go on unemployment. They all worked hard and made a beautiful living in all the countries they went to. I have a Hungarian friend who went to Canada. We were in elementary school together, and there is 6 pages of him on Google of all the things he achieved. So most of the countries were very glad to take in Hungarians.
And one more thing.
Yes. My great-grandparents were Holocaust survivors.
Oh my. That was interesting to hear. And where do they, they still alive?
One's still alive, 97 years old.
Oh my, where does he live?
What?
Where does he live?
New York City.
So you're Jewish?
And Christian.
My grandchildren are Jewish and Christian. Both my children, my daughter lives in Italy, and she married many years to an Italian Catholic. And my son is married to a lady nearly 30 years who was Protestant.
Our flowers. You guys get a card from us as well.
Thank you.
Oh, we have one more.